Hello, I'm Kara O'Donnell, and this is County Board Wrap-Up, our monthly deep dive into the county board actions that affect you, your family, and our entire community. Our guests today are Board Chair Libby Garvey, and joining her is Board Member Matt DeFerranti. Libby, Matt, thank you both for joining us today and for sharing your insights into the board's November meeting. Now, the board's November meeting came in the wake of a presidential election, as we all know, that saw historic levels of turnout, even as the COVID-19 pandemic surged across the nation. The board gave guidance to the county manager for building his proposed fiscal year 2022 budget, a budget that, as we all know, will be greatly impacted by the medical and economic crises caused by that pandemic. The board also approved a name for the historic Green Valley neighborhood's new town square, approved a Columbia Pike redevelopment, and much, much more. Libby, Matt, whew, busy month. But let's start with the budget. Now, believe it or not, time to talk fiscal year 2022 already. And that budget year officially kicked off this month with the board providing the county manager with some guidance for preparing his proposed budget. Now, what parameters did you give the manager and what are the priorities going to be for this year's budget?
Well, the parameters, I mean, the major parameters are what they always are. We have to have a balanced budget. You know, that's at the beginning of every budget we do, and it's one of the things that we're hearing about more even on the national stage because we're depending more and more for federal help because the federal government can go into debt. We can't. And I'm really glad, Kara, that you set up, you kind of did a nice setup for the situation we're in. There is so much swirling around, and yet we've got to stay focused. And one of the things that we're looking at is a large gap between our expected revenues and our expected expenditures, a lot because of COVID. And there's a huge, big question mark about what are we going to get from the federal government. So we're looking at a gap of, you know, in the high 50 millions approximately. And so we've been looking at ways to close that gap. So one of the things we did was we did talk about closeout. We've got some extra, you know, at the end of every year, we've got some money left over. Sometimes people think this is a bad thing. No, no, no. It's just like in your own personal life, you never want to get your checking account down to zero, that you have nothing in it for something. So you always have to have a little bit. And we are using a lot of that, about $13 million or more is going to be carried over to help the budget next year. And so we're really, a lot of what we're finishing up this year is for next year. So the guidance included a couple areas we're really looking at. Many of them, you know, based on COVID and being able to meet the basic needs of our population, that's, I think, our number one priority. I'm sure Matt agrees with me. Got to make sure people have food to eat. You know, roofs over their heads. But there were a couple of other items that are kind of interesting that we've got in there that we are going to be looking at, kind of unrelated. One of them is ranked choice voting. That was a new, that's something that we were given permission to do by the state legislature. We've got a lot of interest in that. So we're going to be looking at that and what's involved with that. Another big one is collective bargaining. We are now, we can have collective bargaining with our police union, our firefighters union, our others, teachers, and that's going to involve some work. So we put some things in the budget to look at those particular items because the work of the budget does absolutely continue on. So I don't know, Matt, what did you think besides the little complete computer freeze we had in the middle of the whole discussion? And I appreciate you and my colleagues just jumping in and rescuing me. Suddenly I couldn't talk. It was very difficult to run a meeting when you couldn't participate.
It's 2020.
Sure. Yeah. I thought you did a great job with that. We managed it as a team. And so I thought that worked out. I mean, you touched on a lot of the big picture that I think is relevant here. And one point that we are so used to, but it bears repeating, is that we continue to have the highest bond rating. We continue to be well fiscally managed. And that really helped us as we sought to address closeout and then the budget guidance for next year. We were able to use some funding to address a gap in this year's budget from closeout. And then the guidance for next year includes, really, we sought to keep flexibility. So there are a couple of ways in which the manager recommended and we agreed with is to use some one-time funding to address the challenges. But we still are going to keep that overall structure of fiscal restraint and smart investment. So that's important. We have a couple of areas in which we think we want to hear and learn about modest the cigarette tax, for example, is an area we now have authority. And that's good policy to help people stay healthy and could give us some small increases in revenues. We also now have the authority on the plastic bag tax, which we want to look at. And so in guidance, we charge the manager with coming back to us with options. We are in a tough environment, but Arlington's strength coming through the BRAC period, the base realignment that happened, which was a huge drop in revenue and jobs for the county, leads me to be cautiously optimistic that we can take seriously the more than $50 million gap that you referred to, but still keep our priorities of helping those most in need and making smart, restrained expenditures. So I think it's good budget guidance in a really tough year.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm going to just repeat a little bit what you said, too, about the one-time money that we're using, because that traditionally, I've done a lot of budgets, and I keep wondering, why doesn't this feel more usual? And I realize, well, it's a very different budget year than anyone we've done before. But usually you don't use one-time money for ongoing expenses. But this time, you know, we've told the manager, and, you know, he suggested, and we agree, that this is such an odd case that this would be a time to do that, because some of the ongoing expenses aren't really ongoing. They're operating, but they're to meet the pandemic. Once the pandemic goes away, those will go away. So using some one-time funds, however we can get them, is really worthwhile to do. So that's important. You know, one of the things I'll talk about, too, is the whole with the, because Matt, you mentioned the BRAC, the base realignment and closing, which really our vacancy rate for built commercial buildings went way up like this. When I got on the board, it was about 12%. This is in 2012. Mm-hmm. It wasn't all that high, but everybody was worried about it. And indeed, it just went up and up and up and up. And we just kept struggling with that. And then, of course, when Amazon came and we got HQ2 here, that stopped that. And then it's been coming down since, because not only is Amazon filling up buildings, but I've been attracting other companies as well. And of course, we had some other ones that came in at that time because we've been working so hard. But thank heavens. That's what because I realized, Matt, I don't know if you noticed, when they showed the graph of where our vacancy rate is again, it's about up. It's not quite up to where we were at our worst. And I was thinking, thank heavens we weren't up at that point when we started going up even more, that we brought it down and we're heading back up. But I don't think it will get much worse than what we had at our worst time before, which is, you know, we managed that before and we'll manage it again. We will.
Yeah, I think that economic development component and work partnering with Amazon has proved to be an important piece. We had no idea we were going to be in this challenge, but it's also a sort of and helpful to keep remembering that jobs are at the center of what we must do. And so there's another project we worked on.
I might bring up one more thing just so people understand. I mean, this is, we keep saying these are difficult budget years. I think this one really will be. You're talking about jobs. We're probably going to have to decrease the number of employees that we've got. And we're trying to find good ways, maybe through retirement and things like that. But there are some services and things that we're going to absolutely, I mean, we've already cut back quite a bit, but we're going to have to, it's just not going to be what people are used to when we come back. So I anticipate some future of these discussions with you, Kara, that are going to be, you know, talking about some really tough decisions that we've got to make. So.
And that actually brings me to my next question is, how hard is it to even start thinking about a fiscal year 22 budget when there's just still so much uncertainty, both at the federal level, we don't know what's going to happen with a virus. Obviously, we're hearing some great news on the possibility of vaccines coming in, but is there concern of this affecting some even core services of the county?
Concern, but I think we'll keep those core services going. I think the key is what Matt brought up, which is flexibility, was what we tried to put in our guidance to the manager, I think.
Yeah, I think core services now are about helping people have food and staying in their homes, avoiding evictions. And we have really made that a priority as a board. And I think there are we have reduced our library services, which is we want to be able to do that. But for safety reasons and also for budget reasons, we've had to reduce. So it depends a little bit on what core services mean to you. If you're without a job and struggling to pay rent, then help from Arlington Thrive is a very core service. And so we'll have to keep, I think it is, Libby, you're entirely right that we are at risk of having to let county employees go. And it is such a priority for the entire board to avoid that. But we also, we have to be fiscally smart as we do this. So,
yeah. And we've already had, I mean, we've let a lot of, you know, temporary part-time employees we have cut back on, as have schools. So these are tight times. Flexibility is key. And yeah, it's hard to think ahead, Carr, but I think we're getting a little used to it. If you'll just remember back when we had that beautiful 400 plus page budget that our manager had put together, we were anticipating the easiest budget year ever. I was just going to coast through this year. It was going to be great.
Famous last words.
The whole thing went out the window, and that's kind of what we've seen. I think we've all gotten used to dealing with the unexpected, and just knowing that we need maximum flexibility, and we need to what we need to hang on to are our core principles, and that's keeping people in their homes and fed. And then I will add, Matt, to those two, the whole healthcare and COVID, the testing, the vaccination, that will be the next priority. So it's food, shelter, and health. And those are the three major, major ones. And then just one more point. We are very aware that health includes mental health. People need to be able to get outside. That's part of the trying to keep the libraries open a little bit. And heavens, anything we could do to get our schools open, and that's providing the internet. And now, yes, now we're into the there's a lot going on. There's a lot to be thinking about, and we're doing our best. We are.
And just to kind of wrap up then, you know, going back to that federal level, with obviously the results still uncertified at this point, but we will be looking at a president-elect Joe Biden. Now, Libby, if you could be a special advisor to the president, how would you advise our new president-elect on how to best help the communities hit hardest by the pandemic? What would you say?
Well, you know, I actually heard him say it. So I'd say, yes, you're right. And that is in a way he's taught. I was just listening to a little newscast thing talking about how your local governments, if we don't provide more help, you know, another CARES Act, a HEROES Act or whatever, it's local government that keeps it all going. We're the ones who have, you've got fire protection because we cover the fire department. If we don't have money and can't balance our budget and we have to let go of the fire department, you're not going to have fire protection. The police, the schools, everything, the most basic functions of government, we at the local level do. And I really have been praising local governments, I think, around the country. I think they have been holding it all together with this poor excuse we have for an administration right now at the top. And it's local governments that have been holding it together and making sure that people are, the basic functions continue. The water we drink. So, I don't know. You asked a quick question. Anyway, absolutely. Support local government. Does that work for you?